You're listening to the Decidedly Podcast with Sanger Smith and Sean Smith. Our mission is to help business owners like you defeat bad decision-making so you can improve your health, wealth, and relationships. We do this by digging deep into the stories and expertise of our guests and distilling their knowledge into actionable wisdom for you to carry into your life and business. If you're new to the show, welcome. Be sure to hit the subscribe button so you won't miss out on any of our weekly episodes. If you prefer to watch this week's episode, head on over to YouTube for the full video. Now, let's get into this week's episode and defeat bad decision-making in your life and business.
Right now, you are listening to this and the solar eclipse has already happened, but right now, as I'm recording this, it has not happened. It's going to happen in about 2 hours, and I'm super excited. I have planned the entire afternoon off work to leave directly from this recording, drive about an hour and a half so I can get a beautiful view with no light pollution, no sound pollution, be kind of in nature, and experience this once-in-a-lifetime moment. And I have been so shocked talking with people. Hey, what are your plans? What are your plans? What are you going to do on Monday for the eclipse? I'm so shocked to see how many people, how many friends of mine are just content to miss it, which is crazy to me. I mean, I asked a friend of mine last night, I said, what are you going to do? He goes, I'm probably just going to miss it. You just work right through it. I go, what? This is not going to happen again in this country for 20 years. And when it does, there's no guarantee that it's going to happen anywhere near where you're living at the time. Why not take a little bit of a productivity hit, a little bit, maybe answer some of these emails a couple hours late to be able to experience something beautiful? And I get it. Just because I care about it doesn't mean that everybody else needs to care about it equally. But I think so many people get wrapped up in what they ought to be doing. I ought to be working. I ought to be productive. I ought to get these things done. I ought to get these chores done. And they forget to do what they want. They forget to do what they ideally would if they could pursue their own desires, interests, duties, and responsibilities wholeheartedly. And it saddens me. It really saddens me. I mean, I guess there might be some employers out there who are telling their employees, nope, can't take off for the eclipse. Can't go outside. Nope, we got to stay at work. Got to pop, 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 cracking the whip. Well, I'd say those people need to get a life. And I get it. If you work for someone like that and your family is relying on that paycheck and there's nothing you can do and you find yourself temporarily stuck in that oppressive environment, I feel for you. I'm not saying you should quit your job and ruin your career so you can watch the eclipse, but I do pray for you that whatever leadership you're getting will improve, because what we think we ought to do is often informed by other people's opinions of us. It's often informed by people outside of ourself and our family and even the people that we love and respect. A lot of times people have this idea of what they should be doing that's motivated by the opinions of people they don't even like. I am thankful for the moments and proud of myself as a leader only a few times, but those times have always been when I've encouraged someone who works for me to pursue something that was in line with their ideal life that they would have created, that lines up with the who they thought they would become when they were younger, the who they thought they would be when they were hopeful. And sometimes that ideal pathway for them is slightly out of alignment from what my selfish interests would be, from what my financial interests would be as the leader of the company. But I try every single time I'm presented with an opportunity to prioritize the ideal for this person, their ideal for themselves, as long as it doesn't violate and destroy my interests and ruin my company. It's probably going to be better for my company long term for this employee to be able to follow their ideal life maybe in the short term, we take a hit. But whether that means letting people bring their young children to work because they don't have daycare or they just don't want daycare, you know? In fact, I don't care if they can't find it. If you just don't want daycare for your three-month-old who's still breastfeeding, bring him to the office. That's cool. Maybe that means working from home because you're taking care of family or an ailing parent or something. You know, maybe that means taking off at what's an inconvenient time for me so that they can pursue something that's purposeful and meaningful for their life. And I know a lot of people would listen to that and be critical. Well, it must be nice here. It must be nice to be able to do that. In my business, we can't do that. In my business, we've got to be open 24/7 and we've got to have da 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 da. You know, and I'd say it is nice. But the only reason that it's possible is because we commit to it. And it's a set of beliefs that we honor and that we respect and we uphold. And if you don't honor, respect, and uphold those beliefs, then yeah, it's going to be even more difficult for you to do it. So whether the set of beliefs that I've described are something that are important to you, that you want to make a reality for your team, I guess what I'm getting at is that we ought to have a set of beliefs at all. You ought to have a set of ideal outcomes, ideal motivations, ideal pursuits, ideal beliefs. And since you're doing that for yourself and for your company, it's a good idea to afford your team to have the opportunity to do that for themselves. Because if they can't explore their ideal life within your company and have to conform their values to yours and their life to yours and their lifestyle to yours and their family dynamics to yours, you know, eventually a good person's going to leave your company. But our guest today is even more focused on bringing these ideas and beliefs into our culture than I am. John R. Miles has a distinguished 30-year career that spans military leadership, entrepreneurship, global business, and strategic innovation. His leadership foundation was initially laid at the United States Naval Academy. He was a D1 athlete at that time, class secretary and brigade honor staff member during a really significant period of the Academy's history. His approach to leadership, it's built upon the rigor of his naval training. It was enhanced with a deep understanding of business dynamics as he became a CIO of a Fortune 50 company. And now, as the visionary CEO of Passion Struck and the host of the number one alternative health podcast, Passion Struck Podcast, he reflects those values and helps his clients, his listeners, his audience find the purpose, find the passion, find the meaning in their life in a world that's constantly pulling us away from that. So stick around, listen to our conversation with John R. Miles. It's valuable. And whether you think you found the ideal path forward for yourself or not, I think this will be a really additive conversation for you. So as always, I'm bringing this to you, fellow business owners who are focused on improving their health, wealth, and relationships. My gift to you is a conversation with John R. Miles. I'm Sanger Smith, and this is Decidedly. Thanks for being here with us today. I'm really excited to talk to you because I think there's a huge overlap in what you do with Passion Struck and what I try to do with my clients and help people find fulfillment and find purpose that's bigger than what they would have found on their own or bigger than what they maybe are currently aiming at. So you have a really unique journey for how you found this new way of thinking about your relationship with life. And I'd love to hear your story. So you were in the military, and then you had a pretty significant life event in 2017 that kind of changed the way that you were thinking. Early on in life, before we get to this big change, you know, what was your relationship like with purpose and meaning? Did you have a religious background? Did you have kind of what was little John like?
Yeah, Sanger, thanks for asking me that. And thank you so much for having me on the show. I'm so honored to be here. I guess Little John grew up in a fairly strict Roman Catholic family. And I had grandparents on both sides of the family who were Catholic. My grandmother, from as far back as I can remember on my father's side, went to church every single day of the week. And so I grew up going to parochial school and really being indoctrinated into the Catholic faith. And when I was 4 or 5 years old, I had another incident happen that also kind of impacted my faith. And that was, I was playing tag in the side yard with a number of the kids in our neighborhood, and the game started getting a little bit rougher, started pushing each other harder. And I remember running away from my friend, and the momentum of me running away and him pushing me on the back launched me forward, and I ended up going headfirst through our basement window. Ended up experiencing a traumatic brain injury, which resulted in a number of repercussions. I, from that point forward, had a speech impediment, cognitive dysfunction from the standpoint of memory issues, not being able to remember words at times, losing space of time, those types of things, and then an auditory processing issue and migraines. And
wow.
So,
and how old were you again?
I was 5 years old.
Man, that's got to be, I'm sure that was really challenging to deal with that type of cognitive impact at such a young age, where I'm guessing you were having a trouble even really understanding what it meant that you were feeling these symptoms.
Yeah, I don't remember a ton from that time. And luckily, I don't remember going through the window or any of that. That's all blacked out. But what I do remember is just feeling I was, from that point forward, different from the rest of the kids. And it caused me for many years to go into a little bit of a bubble, because I was self-conscious about the way that I came about, and especially because of the way I was speaking, and because I would mispronounce words or say the wrong words. It caused me to really close up my communication with others.
Yeah.
And so it taught me a lot at that point, even about meaning and why did things happen to us. And, you know, you read the stories in the Bible, like I was brought up, and now something like this was happening to me at a young age. And I eventually reached this point where at a young age, I decided I can either let this define me, or I can figure out ways to work through this and figure out ways to compensate for these deficiencies and to get through them. And so that's when I ended up having to do, is kind of re-taught myself how to think, speak, and act around different people. Although I still have these issues even today, I've just learned to compensate for them.
Yeah, I was wondering how much of a battle is it even today? Because talking to you, it doesn't, you know, if you told me you have a memory problem and a speech impediment, I'd say, oh, really? It doesn't come through. What is it like trying to overcome it now?
Well, it was compounded because when I was in college, I played rugby. And while playing rugby, I had 2 or 3 more blackout type of concussions. And then when I was in the military, I had a few more. In combat situations and one in training. So looking back now, I've had 5 or 6 of these major things happen. And so each time it's kind of brought on an aggravation of them. And then for me, unfortunately, I think for a lot of people, they'll have a concussion and after a period of time, those symptoms go away. But there are about 5 million people who have post-concussion syndrome where the symptoms don't ever go away completely. And so for me, the hardest thing was trying to exist with a medical system who kept trying to tell me that that wasn't the issue and that there were other things that were causing it, and me eventually having to force the issue and finding out that all along that it was things like vestibular hypofunction and difficulties with seeing a clear line of sight. And, you know, I see those things. For instance, sometimes I'll be walking down the street, and for me, a stop sign will move up and down, where for other people it's stationary. So I just have had to come to grips with it and go through a whole bunch of remedial types of treatment to help me cope with it the best that I can.
It seems like coping with it, or being forced to cope with it, or I would say choosing to cope with it, because you could have made yourself out to be a victim at 5 years old and lived a victim life up until now. You could have gone that route, but you didn't. You said, hey, consciously, I'm going to seek to overcome this. That choice had to have given you a high degree of mental toughness starting at a young age. I mean, most people don't have to overcome anything significant until much later. And you had to overcome it really, really, really early. How much of a difference do you think that made in the path that you chose? Choosing to play rugby, you got to be mentally tough to play rugby. Choosing to go into the military, you've got to be mentally tough to go into the military.
Yeah, I think that was a major turning point for me. When I was graduating high school, junior year, I ended up, beginning of senior year, I ended up getting acceptances to a number of your typical universities. And I think everyone in my family and my friends had always thought I'd end up at the University of Michigan. That's where my parents, grandparents, everyone in my family went, aunts, uncles, and was the university I've always followed the most. But when I got into the Naval Academy and had that opportunity, I looked at the two divergent paths and I knew I wanted to be a leader. I knew I wanted more leadership experience. And I also felt at that point compelled that I wanted to serve. And so I felt by taking this path, by going to the Naval Academy, was going to put me through a much more uncomfortable and challenging position than I would going through a typical university. And it would force me to have to overcome these setbacks that I had even more to excel in that environment. So yeah, that was a big choice, but it's a choice that I've been making throughout my entire life.
Yeah. It takes a really special mindset in an 18-year-old to say, hey, I'm going to seek out the challenge. You know, when I was 18, I wanted to seek out the comfort. I wanted to seek out the easy path. I said I would discount certain majors that I could have pursued in college. I heard that one's really hard. It wasn't for me until later in life that I realized, oh, that's not a mindset that's going to carry me to where I want to go. I need to seek out those challenges, but you kind of always had it. And the Naval Academy is about as far different from a college experience as you could get from the University of Michigan's typical undergrad.
Yeah, night and day. So, I mean, there are some times I look back as I'm watching my own kids go through college where I wish I would have had the normal college experience, but you can't trade the overall impact that it's had on life, the relationships that I developed, and the situations we get put into that a typical 18 to 21-year-old are never going to have those type of opportunities presented to them. So I have never regretted it and feel like it was one of the most fulfilling periods of my life, even though while you're going through it, at times it's not the most pleasant experience, but coming out of it, it is such a rewarding and uplifting thing to do to have done.
Yeah. So when you were making these decisions, whether it was to consciously overcome the difficulties of your brain injury, joining the rugby team, going to the Naval Academy, seeking out challenge after challenge after challenge, how much of that was a conscious pursuit of purpose and meaning versus like maybe a reflexive response that you kind of had accidentally stumbled into to a life of seeking out hard things?
That's an interesting question. I would say that both my parents and especially my maternal grandparents were hard on all of my siblings and I about crafting a life that we did something that we felt was of importance. So I think ever since I can remember, I was kind of brought up in this sense that I was going to be a high achiever, and then it just was a matter of what I was going to apply that to. I think my grandparents would have preferred I become a doctor or an attorney rather than take the path that I did. But I kind of knew no matter what I was going to end up doing, that come one way or another, I was going to become successful in it, because I just always had that mentality of wanting to work, wanting to explore, wanting to do things and to excel in it, whatever I put my mind to.
So what was it like learning to lead teams in the military? I mean, I've only ever led people in the corporate sector. I had a glimpse through the behind the curtain of what military life is like. I went to Texas A&M and was in the Corps of Cadets for 4 years. So I didn't serve, but I like played pretend Naval Academy like a little bit, if you could call it that, in the Corps of Cadets. And I carry with me a ton of what that like military leadership lessons were. But what was it like for you? Because I'm sure you still implement a large degree of those unique lessons today.
Yeah, well, I'm going to just start out with the Naval Academy, and then I'll bridge this into the actual military experience. I have a friend who played for Kansas State, and he was a first team All-American, three-time Big 12 Player of the Year, drafted to go in the NFL, and he didn't even last a season in the NFL. When he got to the combine and started to see the other players, he realized that he was average at best when compared to the other athletes who were there. And that's kind of how I felt when I got into the Naval Academy. I mean, the caliber of the people there was so high. I mean, everyone was in the top of their class. Everyone was a team sports captain. Everyone was on student council. And so the competition level was extremely high. So when you talk to someone who's at a service academy and they finish in the last quarter of their class, I mean, you're comparing these people to the elite across the country who even got in. So that was one thing for me, was that the level of competition was extremely high, which meant I had to find ways to elevate my game if I wanted to finish in the top quarter of the class, which I ended up doing, to excel in that way. When I got into the military itself, the military is a lot different than the, I guess, world that the Naval Academy made it out to be. I mean, the real world and the pretend military are two different things. And so what I experienced, because I had a great position where I got to go, I was what they call, let me take a step back. I was a Naval Information Warfare Officer. I worked for the National Security Agency. In my first tour of duty, I was based in Rota, Spain, and I was put into a billet called a direct support officer. And so the beauty of this is we get deployed on specialized missions that are all dependent on the mission. So for me, it could have been on an aircraft carrier, it could have been on a ship, it could have been in an aircraft, could have been on a sub, and eventually it was with SEAL teams. And so I was thrust in these situations at a very young age where I had to take a specialized team, and the team was always different that I took out. So the type of leadership I had to do from the get-go was I had to learn how to bond and trust the senior most enlisted person that I was being deployed with, because the success or failure of the mission, I found very early on, was not inherently in my skill set. It was in their skill set and how well we operated together and were a cohesive unit. And through that, how well we were going to lead the team together. And so that was one key aspect. Another one was, imagine you're a junior officer and you kind of have to keep getting reinserted into new wardrooms every time that you're going onto a vessel. So I had to learn had to go into different situations, foreign situations, because everyone I went into, it's a different commanding officer who's leading it. And how do you not only bond with those senior officers, but how do you bond with your peer group that's in those situations so that you come in and you hit the ground running? Another thing that I think was really important was that a lot of these people didn't understand what we were doing or what the function was. And in many cases, we couldn't really tell them. And so it was, how do you project what you're doing and its importance for why you're taking up space on that ship with giving them enough information that it makes them understand what you're there for, but protecting what you're there to do as well, because you couldn't give too much away. So it was really information discretion was something that I had to learn at a very young age, and how to properly handle information, what to disclose, what not to disclose.
Yeah, it's a blessing in a way to be forced to lead people who are more experienced than you. You know, because you cannot lead from a position of authority. You can't say, hey, I'm the boss here. That's not going to work with a enlisted guy who's been in the Navy for 20 years and you just graduated from Annapolis like last May.
Oh, completely not. I mean, if you take that route, your life is going to be living hell. So I just went around and found people that I could trust to ask them questions about the senior enlisted people I was going to be working with, and were they really buttoned down themselves. And then once I formed those relationships, really just going 100% into them to make sure that we had as tight a relationship as we could, to the point when we were going on deployments that we could almost read each other's thoughts, so that we could cover for each other if needed. And we would always be in lockstep with what was going on. So that was extremely important.
When you were early on in your career, or maybe even in the Naval Academy, and you're around people who are learning, and when people are learning to be leaders, they're going to make mistakes in leadership. What mistakes did you make, or did other people make, that you observed that stuck with you where you said, you know what, that's one way to definitely not do it in the future?
So one of my roommates was a varsity swimmer, fantastic guy. He was really struggling with the academics that we were going through. And to put it into perspective, most of the time I was carrying 20 or more credits per semester. So it's a heavy load. And when you're a varsity swimmer and, you know, he's waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning and doing his morning training and then afternoon training, he's completely exhausted. So I saw him really struggling for years. And at the junior year, we're all required to take electrical engineering. And it's a very difficult class pretty much for everyone, unless I guess you're a genius. And he was failing out of this class. And I kept encouraging him that maybe the best thing to do is to give up on swimming, or to find some way that you could do this in summer school or some other way, because you're putting so much pressure on yourself, it's going to end badly. And unfortunately, on one of the exams, he made the decision to cheat on it and was caught. And when I was there at that time, an honor offense was black or white. If you were found guilty, you were expelled. And because he had gone past his junior commitment, which means we have this event called 2 for 7, meaning you have 2 more years and then you serve 5 years beyond that, because he had crossed that point. Not only did he get kicked out, but then he had to serve for a defined period of time as an enlisted person in the Guard. So,
wow,
huge implications. And I wish, looking back and observing that he would have just given up the swimming and taken that load off of him and realized that the more important goal was getting through the academy. So that was one big learning opportunity. Another one was my plebe year. I had a Marine Corps roommate who we had actually gone to the Naval Academy Preparatory School together. was one of my best friends, and he went home on leave and ended up getting his girlfriend, he thought, pregnant. And I think in retrospect, he did what he thought was the honorable thing to do. He went forward and told the administration that he had gotten this girl pregnant, which also resulted in immediate expulsion and him going back into the fleet as a Marine. I think in retrospect, he should have done his due diligence more about exactly what was going on, because it turns out that the girl was lying to him and was trying to use this as a way to get him to come back home.
And no.
So two terrible That's situations horrible. Where people lost their dreams because of mistakes. And this is one of the things I really talk about is, I think getting through the academy, as Angela Duckworth says in her book, Grit, definitely takes passion and perseverance. You have to be passionate to be there to begin with, but to get through all the obstacles, you need to persevere through them. But I think what both these examples show is that you also have to be very intentional about your actions. And you can make choices, as they did, that lead you away from your ultimate goal, or you can make choices and take intentional actions that take you closer. And that was one of the most important things that I learned by observing that, is that if you find yourself not on the course that is going to take you to your end destination, then you have to have the self-control to realize it, adapt, and make changes to get yourself back on track.
Yeah. Both of those stories are heartbreaking. It's amazing. Is that not still the rule? Because you said when you were there, if you cheat, you're out. Have they changed that or got more relaxed on that?
They've actually changed it. When Vice Admiral Ted Carter was the superintendent two superintendents ago, he actually went back to the original group of people who suggested the current honor code. And these were people from Jimmy Carter's time at the Naval Academy.
Okay.
And they actually came back and said that their intention was never to make it black and white. It was, I mean, certainly there are things that you do, like if you are found taking heroin, they're obviously going to kick you out. Or if you steal from
burn the flag or
store,
something.
Yes, they're going to kick you out. But what they were wanting was more of a learning laboratory, that if you do make a mistake, you get punished for it, but you have the opportunity to continue. So it is adapted to that. But when I was going through, we were only graduating somewhere between 60 to 70% of the starting class. They're now graduating above 90%. So there've been a lot of changes over time to get it to that higher graduation rate.
Is that a good thing, to increase graduation rate?
Well, depending on who
because they could make it 100 if they wanted, just have no standards, for example.
Yeah, I have not spent enough time back at the academy to understand the intricacies of what has changed to be qualified to make an answer on that. I mean, to me, it seems like it's gotten, I mean, everyone who goes to any of the service academies will tell you, when I was a mid, it was so much harder than when you were a mid.
Yeah.
But there does seem to be something that it has softened it a lot from when I was there to what it's like now.
How much of those stories that you hear are exaggerations? Because I'm sure you've heard your buddies tell stories. Oh man, back when we were there, remember when this happened? You go, did it really happen that way, or are we just remembering it because it sounds cooler?
I think some of them are absolutely true. I think it was very different there before 1980, when females were first brought in. And I've heard that the amount of hazing that went on was significantly higher up into that, before that point, when it was all male. But then if you were those first groups of females that went through, I heard they were tormented, basically. It's amazing any of those initial groups of female midshipmen in any of the academies got through. And I've talked to numerous ones who were in those initial classes just to understand how difficult it was. I even saw changes when I was there from when I was a plebe to when I was a junior, what they call a second class, and what we were allowed or not allowed to do in the form of discipline and even physical things that we were allowed to have the midshipmen do. It changed pretty drastically, even in a period of 2 years. So I think over time, when those things keep on happening, and they're probably trying to do them to keep people safer, but it definitely, those are the things that I think people say it was so much more difficult when I was there.
Yeah. How do you balance that in business? Because, you know, in my industry, a lot of guys who started in the 80s or 90s, like they had a very particular way that they were successful. And the benefit is that it was really hard for them to go out and get new business. I mean, hey, bud, here's a 6-week training course. We're going to pay you 100% commission. You need to go knock on doors, read names out of the phone book. Like, you're just going to go find somebody to hire you. And if you don't, you're going to go broke and you're going to quit. The downside is a lot of people who might have been really good advisors, really competent guides for their clients, they didn't get the opportunity to realize that because they couldn't be a good salesman under intense pressure. And so it's a trade-off. All the guys who made it have this intense ability to connect with other people. They have amazing sales skills and they have a lot of grit. Like, they toughed it out for a period of several years, making no money. Same time, we lost a lot of people in the industry who might have made the industry better as a whole. And so now I see guys who went through this experience in the 80s and 90s and they came up in a particular pathway. They're hiring advisors who are, you know, right out of college, and they kind of want those guys, those new hires into the industry, to go through the same experience that they had in the 80s and 90s. And it, number one, it doesn't work. It doesn't work anymore. When the industry was in its infancy, you could just go meet people and get clients with no experience because you were offering a service that had very low market awareness. So once you made people aware of it, they're like, oh, okay. Well, now most people have a wealth advisor. And so you're competing as a 22-year-old college grad. You're competing with a 52-year-old who had 30 years of experience who's currently working for this family. You're going to lose that battle. But despite that, I see a lot of business owners, a lot of advisors say, well, this is what I did, so I'm going to make these guys do it.
Yeah, well, I think the world we live in today is a lot different than it was in the 80s and 90s, for sure. And I think, especially in the field that you are in, it's matured a lot more from that point. And therefore, people have a lot better understanding of what a financial service provider should do. I mean, to me, it's, the two are completely different disciplines, but when I look at a realtor and I look at how some of the ones who've been around for a long time had to start their path and had to go for a long period of time without making a lot of income to build up the skill set to get to where they are. And today you've got a lot more different ways for a new person in that profession to come on board. The biggest of which is people have teams now. And so you can get with an experienced agent who's going to give you leads right to your doorstep that make it easier for you to get a book of business rather than having to do it from scratch like many had to do when they were starting out. And from what I've seen in your industry as well, I have, my best friend is a financial advisor for LPL, and he brings new people in, but he sets them up for success because he already has a big book of business. And so he brings them in a way where initially they're not even serving the client. They're kind of doing
back office work.
Yes. And then he, as he matures them or guides them, then he'll bring them into more of a front office type of opportunity. So,
yeah, I think sometimes it kind of takes, It takes leaving your ego at the door as a leader to say, you know what? Like, I want to put this person through what I went through, because in some way it like validates the importance of that suffering that I had to experience, right? You know, we like to tell ourselves, rightly or wrongly, hey, the suffering that I went through made me better, right? Because it's so tragic to say the suffering I went through made me worse, especially if that suffering was imposed on me. Like, I didn't choose it. It happened to me. Or I was recommended to go through this suffering by someone who talked me into going to the Naval Academy or whatever. It's like, hey, the hazing helped me. And you know, in most cases, like, yeah, maybe it did. But for some people, it hurt them. Well, they've got a choice. Can they say, oh, this hazing made me worse and it made me lose my confidence? Or can they say, this hazing toughened me up and I'm glad I did it? Well, I think they cope with it and say, I'm glad I did it. And then when it comes time for them to lead, well, I've got to put these people through what I went through. And it takes a really smart leader like your friend to say, you know what? I went through this. It's probably best that these people that I lead go through a little bit softer experience, a little bit easier experience. Maybe I can get them to where I got to without them needing to suffer like I did. And if you can, that's a huge win.
Well, I think for a listener, I mean, what they need to consider is that whatever it is you want to achieve, you've got to back into it. So for example, I wanted to be a chief information officer. So I did a whole ton of research on what are the different pathways that people take to becoming a chief information officer? What are the basic skill sets that you need? And what is the most likely path to get there? It's similar to astronauts that I know who wanted to become an astronaut. Well, what's the simplest way to figure that out? Well, you look at the ones who were selected before you and you look at what are the major skill sets that they had that the majority possessed. And so for me, that's how I started shaping my career, is I knew I needed information security experience. I knew I needed infrastructure experience. I needed operations. I had to have big data. I had to have application development. I had to lead different diverse groups. I had to understand strategy. And it was purposely trying to put myself into roles over a period of time that would allow me to do those things, that I had enough of the tickets punched that I set myself up to be an ideal position to become a CIO. And I think the same thing is important for anything that we want to pursue.
What was your transition like to starting PassionStruck?
Well, there were a number of different things going on when I started this. I could almost go all the way back to 2009 being an incremental point for the journey that I'm on today. However, I didn't really launch PassionStruck to say until 2020. But it was at this point in time, kind of 2008, 2009, that I started to hear really two voices. And I'm not talking schizophrenic type voices. I'm saying that typically we're guided by a loud inner voice that's generally telling us that the path we're on is right, and keep going through the motions, do the things you're doing, you're improving, you're hitting the milestones. And then I kind of went through this period of deep self-awareness during this period of time where I was doing more introspection. I had gotten back into mindfulness and was really thinking about where my life was. And I started to hear this quieter voice that took me a lot of effort to even hear, that was really telling me that the path that I was on was not the one that I was meant to be doing. And it wasn't really bringing me happiness and fulfillment in the way that was going to bring me long-term satisfaction with my life. But when you start hearing this voice, it's difficult to make that transition. I mean, at this point in time, I'm a C-level in a Fortune 50 company making seven figures. I have what I thought was everything I had ever wanted professionally. And I slowly began to realize that even though I had outwardly shown success and what many people would look at a resume as saying this fantastic career, my inside was at the same path starting to fall apart because I had put so much emphasis on these external factors of what I thought were going to bring success. I was ignoring the most important factors, which were my relationships, my physical and mental health, and my emotional health, and all those things, as quickly as I was climbing the ladder, were deteriorating in parallel to it. And so that gap was widening, and it was a fight because this path that I was doing felt really good. It felt like I was accomplishing what I thought I wanted, but internally, I really wasn't doing anything that as a kid I imagined I would be doing with my life. I really wasn't helping others. I wasn't serving the world in ways that my uniqueness could really help people and help make a difference. And so that transition point ended up taking longer than I would have ever thought. But I think what ends up happening is you don't get to point A overnight. And so to get to this next inflection point that you want, you're not going to get there overnight either. So I think it comes full circle back to the discussion that you were having with me that you can't be a new college grad and expect to be the CIO tomorrow. I couldn't go from where I was to then starting PassionStruck without having to go back and rebuild critical aspects of my life from scratch, which is what I ended up doing to learn this new path that I needed to go on and to make myself a better person.
What do you think was the biggest reason why you were not doing the things as an adult that you thought you would be or wanted to do when you were a young child?
Well, I guess I always thought I was going to have this life of adventure, and I was certainly having that when I was in the military, and I got out only because I had accepted a special agent position with the FBI, where I was going to be doing counter-drug type of interdiction type work for them. And then life throws you some curveballs, and a few days before my Quantico class was supposed to hit, my detailer called me and said, Congress can't pass a budget. Class has unfortunately been recycled. And naively, I thought that meant, okay, well, I get to go back in a couple months. Well, he then said, no, it doesn't work like that. You're talking at least a year and a half, more likely 3 years before you're going to have another opportunity. So at that point, I didn't have a plan B. I mean, who thinks your Quantico class isn't going to happen? So I was thrust into a position where I needed money, and I had to get a job because I was married at the time. So that's what I ended up doing. And so I ended up going into this civilian path that I don't think I ever projected I would go into, especially at that age. And then once I was in it, when 3 years came up, at this point I had a son on the way and the opportunity had kind of passed itself up. So now I find myself in this civilian career where, as I mentioned at the beginning, whatever I put my mind to, I'm wired to want to be as successful as I can at it. So I just kind of went with the flow of life and kind of hopped from one position to another now that I found myself here, where I think looking back, I had another pinnacle point where I went into the consulting world after the military, started at Booz Allen, ended up at Arthur Andersen, where I was a practice leader. And after a short period of time, 3 years with Arthur Andersen, the Enron company issue happened and Arthur Andersen went out of business literally in a period of 3 or 4 weeks from the point that that was, that manifested. And I think at that point, looking back, I had a choice where I could have taken a completely different path and decided to go back to school or do something different with my life. And instead, that's when I decided to go into industry and kind of pursue the path that I was already on. So looking back, that would have been an inflection point where I had the opportunity to make a shift. And I wish I would have taken more time to really think things out at that point. But life happens sometimes and you just go with it.
Yeah. What do you think is the number one thing people need to focus on in order to be able to find and define the passion that exists within them? Because you were fortunate to have this high level of self-awareness and recognize, hey, what I'm doing, even though I'm receiving rewards, it's not like you were unsuccessful. You weren't at some rock bottom in life saying, clearly this isn't working out. Seems like things were really working out and you were realizing you were unfulfilled. When I work with clients, a lot of times they have that same type of outlook is, hey, my business is succeeding. My income's very high. And maybe they even have a great family life. Like on paper, there's nothing wrong. They might not even necessarily think anything's off kilter, but they're not pursuing purpose and meaning to the fullest extent that they could. And just because we're not doing something as good as it could be done doesn't mean that we have a litany of problems. So for a lot of them, they're unaware. What do people need to do in order to become aware, like you did? Hey, there's something higher that I could aim at. And then two, what do they do to craft it and define it and actually aim at it?
Well, I think it starts with the vast majority of people today, I think, are living their lives not on autopilot, but I like to describe it as if they're a pinball in the game of pinball. We are so unintentional about the way we're approaching life that we're like that aimless pinball that just bounces off all the things that we encounter, all the distractions, all the different things that the game players put in our way to keep us from being focused on winning the game. And I think the first thing that a person needs to do is to stop and start allowing yourself to focus on both the short term and what's happening in your life and the longer term outlook of what you've wanted to accomplish with your life. And I think the difficulty in doing that is that life gets very busy. And so it becomes more and more difficult as we get older to have the patience and the discipline to let yourself sit with where your life is now and understand what's working and what's not. And I think there's this thing called self-discrepancy theory, which basically says that we have three versions of ourself. We have our actual self, our odd self, and our ideal self. Our actual self is who we are in this very moment as you and I are talking. Our odd self is who we think we should be. And that's where I think most people end up living their life. And then we have our ideal self, which is who we could become. And our odd self is really dictated by everything from our family upbringing, like my grandparents who were saying to me, you need to be a high achiever. We want you to be a doctor or a lawyer. Or it could be from the friends that you hang out with, or from what you think society is telling you you ought to be, or it could be because of your family obligations. You have kids now, and so you feel like you have to take this route, and it becomes harder and harder and harder as we get older to look at that path of becoming our ideal self. And then once you actually realize that difference, it's then coming to terms and allowing yourself to sit with, am I my ought self? Am I living my life as my ideal? What does my ideal really even mean? And so then you have to go through a much deeper exercise of, you know, what is really driving me in life? I mean, what is the end goal? Is the end goal to have a lot of money and a big house? And that's your goal? Is your goal to have as long as a health span as you possibly can with your lifespan? Is it that I want to have strong relationships? So you need to start defining those things. And I think the analogy that I make in the book that you have in front of you is I use the analogy of a mission angler. So an angler being a fisherman. And when I look at those people who love to fish and who are very good at it, they are extremely focused in doing that discipline. meaning they pick the very early morning hours to go out, because typically where I live in Tampa Bay, they're trying to get 30, 40 miles out. And so they want to get out at a specific time of the day so it's not too hot. They're looking at tides, they're looking at moon phases, all these different things. They're extremely intentional about it. Yet, how many of us are that intentional about our own life and how we're trying to live it? So I think that's what people need to start realizing. And so you're not going to just find this purpose or this passion overnight. It's going to take time. And I think a lot of experimentation to understand what motivates you, what gets you to feel excited. What are those things that you love to do that you can do in a way that's going to help someone else?
Yeah, the difference between the ideal and the ought is sometimes massive. And I notice that a lot of people are very critical of themselves, because this shows up in money conversations all the time. People are very critical of themselves by saying, well, my ought self is different than my actual self. And so when they start describing things that they want to change or that they're not doing or that they're doing that they want to stop doing, a lot of times when I ask questions, I start to find out that they're comparing their actual to their ought. And like you said, the ought is what's essentially like prescribed to them based on their interpretation of what other people's values are. You know, the external pressures that we receive from our parents, our community, our neighborhood, our culture, the country we live in can have an influence on what our ought self should be. But then when people identify their ideal self, I find two things. One is sometimes there's a smaller gap between the ideal and the actual than there is between the ought and the actual, which means it's easier to get into alignment than they even thought. Or two, there's often big, massive differences between the ideal and the ought. Sometimes there's alignment. There are things that people want to do that are in both the ideal and the ought. But when people get clear on their ideal, they go, oh, I didn't know I was allowed to do this. Like, I didn't know that I could pursue this. I didn't know that it was okay to prioritize this in my life. And so for some people, for example, like I've talked to clients who realize, you know, I don't have to own a home at all. The idea that I have to own a home and progressively get a nicer home every decade, that was imparted upon me by others. That's not a value of mine. I don't have to do that. I want to not have a home. That way I can ideally move around and explore different areas of the country because I work remote and I don't need to be in one spot. Oh, wow, that's great. If you had prioritized upgrading the kitchen every 3 years, we would have sacrificed this ideal.
Yeah, I think we get wedded down in our minds, maybe by what our parents have or what we see other people have as being this vision of what we ourselves have to accomplish. And I think the older I've gotten, the less I see the need in having these huge monetary things, because all they do is bring you more burdens. And I have been trying over time to simplify my life as I get older, not make it more complex. But I think each person is wired so differently, to your point, that a lot of times we just fall in this trap of wanting to accumulate more and more and more.
Yeah.
And I have found all that has brought me is discontent instead of fulfillment.
Well, what do you think is the key to identifying that ideal self? Because I haven't necessarily figured out what the key is, and a lot of my clients struggle with it, but identifying the key, the ideal self, painting a very clear picture, what do we need to do in order to get there?
So generally, there are three things that we as humans need to have to feel that we have fulfillment. One is we need to feel relatedness, meaning we need to have strong relationships with other people that give us a sense of purpose and meaning. We need to have autonomy, meaning We need to feel that we have a choice and we willingly endorse our own behavior. The opposite of that is feeling compelled or controlled. And then we need to have competence, which is a feeling of mastery over something in our life where we're highly effective in doing an activity. And these are the three things that when you look at blue zones across the world, that the people who have lived the longest, they have these three major buckets that define their life. So autonomy, competence, and relatedness. And it just turns out that two scientists, Edward Deci and Richard Ryan, discovered this and termed it self-determination theory. And I think that it is these three components and looking at what you ideally would like your life to be like, and then how do you basically build that with these three things in it. So how do you create a life with personal agency so that you are directing it in the way that you want it? What are the competencies that if you want to achieve that, you need to master in this life plan? And then what are the relationships that you need to have in your life to give you that foundation over which those two things can sit upon, is how I would approach it.
That makes sense. What do you think is your final tip for business owners who want to improve their health, wealth, and relationships?
I think one of the most fundamental things you've got to question yourself is, what does success look like to you? And perhaps redefine it. Redefine the conventional measures or metrics of success that you've been led to believe dictate how you should be living your life. So instead of measuring your worth by wealth and possessions, redefine success in terms of personal growth and the positive impact that you have on others. And perhaps it's experiencing more awe and more gratitude and more kindness in your life.
Thanks, John. I'm glad you came on today. Where can people connect with you and the work that you're doing?
The best ways to connect with me are through either my personal website at johnrmiles.com or our company website at passionstruck.com. And from there, you can learn more about my podcast, Passion Struck, or my book that is behind me and in front of you, and everything else that we're doing.
Well, thanks, John.
Thank you so much for having me.
My takeaway from talking with John is the difference between our ideal self and our ought self. So many times when I work with clients, I see during an attempt to create an image and a vision for their ideal life, they start telling me things that are really the desires of other people for their own life, whether it's their parents, their family, their community, the culture they belong to. And it doesn't align with what they actually want. And so my takeaway moving forward is to understand the difference in my own life and the lives of the people that we work for, it decidedly, the difference between the ideal and the ought, and make sure that we're not mistakenly aiming at the ought when we should be or ought to be aiming at the ideal.
You just made a great decision to listen to this episode of Decidedly. Make another great decision by subscribing to the show and leaving us a 5-star review wherever you're listening. We appreciate the support. It helps business owners like you find our community and defeat bad decision-making in their own lives. For more decision-making insights, check us out at decidedlypodcast.com, on Instagram at decidedlypodcast, or grab a copy of Sanger and Sean's books from the links in the show notes. Finally, we'd like to thank Shelby Peterson of Transcend Media for editing and post-production of the show. Thanks for listening. I'm Morgan, your producer, and this is Decidedly.